Good morning, church. God is in this place today. Amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Before we get started this morning, we got our friends here from Albany Adult and Teen Challenge. What is up, fellas? They have a table out in the foyer for the 5K that we have been advertising for the last couple of weeks. Run to recovery, right? Or recover, right? Right? Yeah. So on your way out, if you feel so led to sponsor them, or maybe you're going to run. You laugh at that. See, like, I'll write a check. Don't be silly. Stop by that table. Let's support them as they continue to raise money. What a great program, setting people free from the bondage of addiction. So stop by, visit them at their table. Also, as Pastor David mentioned in one of the 47 announcements he taped, Easter is only 2 weeks away. We have our Easter invites. They are on the black tables as you leave. They are also out at the welcome desk. These are useless to me after Easter. So take a couple and invite someone who doesn't have a church home, someone who doesn't know Jesus, and invite them to come to church. It's Easter Sunday. The only people who will say no to you are axe murderers. Everybody else will come to church on Easter. So invite them to come out, grab an invite or two. This one's actually time sensitive because we're only a couple weeks away from Easter. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Ephesians chapter 5, and we're going to get there in just a minute. We spoke last Sunday about salvation. The title of the message was Being Saved. We talked about what it is, and I want to share a little bit about what it isn't. Because as we kind of review this first topic, let's be very clear on what we're talking about. What does it mean to be saved? Salvation is not, I repeat, salvation is not just being a good person. Salvation is not just going to church. Salvation is not doing, you know, good things, giving to the poor or something. Salvation is not a family tradition. None of those things have the power to save us. Salvation is what we talked about last week, a personal relationship that you have with Jesus Christ. We talked about the ABCs of salvation. We talked about admitting that you're a sinner, believing that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died on a cross for our sins, that he rose again, and confessing our sins to him, confessing Jesus as Lord. ABC, salvation, addresses mankind's sin problem. Nothing else could do that. If anything else could do that, Jesus would not have had to come and die on a cross. That is the only way that we are saved. So we talked about salvation last week, and this week, in our kind of three-part little mini-series, Saved, Filled, Sent, I want to talk to you today about being filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. So let's start off with a few key points, and then we'll get to the passage in Ephesians. We know from Scripture that when you are saved, if you have accepted Jesus into your heart, the Holy Spirit has come, and he resides in you. The Holy Spirit is in you at salvation, 100%, no doubt about it. We also read in Acts chapter 2 that a group of people who were already followers of Jesus, we would say they were already saved, were baptized in the Holy Spirit. This was a separate experience, separate from salvation. It was accompanied by the outward sign, the physical sign. They spoke in other tongues. We read about that in the book of Acts. And the purpose, we're going to talk about purpose today, was the power to live for Jesus and be his witnesses. At salvation, the Holy Spirit comes in you. Subsequently to that, you can be baptized in the power of the Holy Spirit. And then there's a third one. That's the one I want to talk about the most today. We're instructed in Scripture to be continuously filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Not just saved. Yeah, want to be saved. That's good. Not even just baptized in the Holy Spirit. Also good. Also important. But we're given this idea in Scripture that we need to be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. There's evidence in Scripture of a process where believers who were baptized in the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit, were then filled again. Because as they went out and they served God, it drains them. Do you ever feel drained in your walk with the Lord? So there's this concept in Scripture, and I'm not trying to like make a doctrine out of it, but where believers who were already saved, already baptized, were filled again. Ephesians 5, 18. Let's look at this a little bit. It says this: do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Don't be drunk. The scriptural warnings, Old Testament, New Testament, against drunkenness are very clear. Scripture warns us against the excesses. It warns us against indulging the flesh. Paul uses wine here, but there's a greater application. Pursuing the pleasures of the flesh, becoming distracted with the things of this world. And it doesn't have to be wine. You could be drunk with more than wine, right? We can be drunk for power. We could be drunk with pride, greed, lust, you name it. The pleasures of the flesh, don't get caught up in that. Instead, we're told, be filled with the Spirit. Now, I don't know what version you have of the Bible, but in studying this is written in Greek, very specific language, it translates differently. It doesn't just say be filled with the Holy Spirit, but the tense of being filled is such that it commands us to continually, constantly live filled with the Holy Spirit. It's not a command for one-time use, it's a command for lifetime use. The baptism in the Holy Spirit is a one-time event in your life, but it's not meant to be a one and done. We're to live continually filled with the Holy Spirit. And if we are going to represent Jesus well in this world today, we had better be filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm sure some of you have seen the meme that was making the round, says, do we need the Holy Spirit to be a Christian? It says, you need the Holy Spirit to go to Walmart. Amen, especially Altamont Ave. And I'm not judging, I'm just saying, you need some Jesus if you're gonna roll into that place. We are to be filled with the Holy Spirit all the time. There is not a day that goes by where it would not benefit you to be filled to overflowing with the power of the Holy Spirit. And that is precisely what Scripture tells us to do. The church, and the church are people, we need to be continuously filled with the Holy Spirit. I would go a step further and say that this world needs the church to be filled with the Holy Spirit. A world that doesn't know Jesus needs us to be on fire for him, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit so we can share our faith, so we can represent him well. Your family, your children, mom and dad, they need you to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We all need to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, not one time, continuously. Continuously. Let's look at a couple passages in the book of Acts. We're going to start in Acts chapter 4, a story with Peter and John. We're told in Acts chapter 4, verse 8, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, speaks to some of the rulers and religious leaders. This is Peter, whose life has changed dramatically, because in Acts chapter 2, we're told about Pentecost. In Acts chapter 2, the disciples, fresh off Jesus ascending into heaven, obey his command, and they go into Jerusalem, and Jesus told them, wait for the promise of the Father. They didn't know what that meant. They certainly didn't know what that would look like, what shape, form, they had no idea. But they went to the upper room, and there they just began to pray and wait as Jesus told them to. Crazy, crazy concept. Jesus told them to do something, and they went and did it. Revolutionary. We should adopt that. So they went, they did it. As they are there praying, the Bible tells us, Acts chapter 2, verse 4, the Holy Spirit descends on them. They had no idea. And it was weird. Wind started whistling around. they get these little flames of like fire over their head. That's never happened to me. Anybody? No? Okay. So weird. And then they all start prophesying in tongues. They start speaking in other languages. Absolutely wild. The power of the Holy Spirit falls on them. They have this incredible, it was a one-time experience. Acts chapter 2 happened once. And then from there, they go out with this renewed power, a supernatural power to share Jesus. Peter, who only a few weeks earlier curses out a servant girl because she tries to identify him as someone who was with Jesus, curses her out. The same Peter, now filled with the Holy Spirit, walks out onto the porch after the Holy Spirit falls, and he preaches a word, and 3,000 people come to the Lord. It is a stark contrast of Peter before the Holy Spirit and Peter after the Holy Spirit. He speaks in power, and many come to the Lord. So this is why God tells us to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. Who doesn't want to be more powerful in their faith? I prefer weak and anemic, Pastor. The power sounds good. I prefer to struggle and really just kind of go that way. We want the power of the Holy Spirit. So that's Acts chapter 2. We're two chapters later. Peter and John are walking through and they see a man who's crippled. He's begging. I think you remember the phrase, silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to you in the name of Jesus, arise and walk. Peter and John pray for this man. He gets up, he's healed. It's amazing. Everyone is like, wow, and they want to hear about this Jesus, except the religious leaders. They pull Peter and John in for questioning. So this is where Acts chapter 4 takes us. And as they question Peter and John, Peter to the rulers, remember, same guy who denied Jesus three times, comes out with this one. In verse 8, he says, rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if this day were judged for a good deed done to a helpless man and by what means he's been made well, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but God raised from the dead, by him this man stands before you whole. Pete's a different dude. He's a different guy because the Holy Spirit had filled him with power. Peter and John are persecuted for their faith and they're released. And it's a good story. You could read it in Acts chapter 4. But I want you to look at verse 31, and I'm going to put it on the screen. Peter and John go back with the 12. They counted it an honor. They counted it a privilege to suffer for Jesus. They go back, they tell the 12, and they have a prayer meeting together. And look at Acts 4:31. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Now, here's the thing. Peter and John were already saved. Peter and John were already baptized in the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. This is later. This is after giving out. They just prayed, and the Holy Spirit refilled them again so that they could go and continue to speak the word with boldness. So when you look through the scripture and you just examine an entirety of the evidence, not only are we called to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, we're called to live that way, to be continually filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Every single moment of every single day, Peter and John, in the face of opposition, stood strong in the power of the Holy Spirit. And you will face opposition in your life for being a follower of Christ. You will face opposition maybe at your job. You'll face opposition in maybe your home. Maybe in your neighborhood, maybe in a friendship circle, there will be opposition to what the Lord wants to do in your life. And I'll repeat this a few times today because we forget this. Because I think there's something natural in us that wants to be liked. We want people to like us. And that stands in stark contrast to what Jesus said when he said, "You'll be hated by everyone because of me." Believer, I want you to know today, the opinions that you hold that are based in God's word are very unpopular. And they are out of the mainstream of culture. This is not a Republican or Democrat issue. This is a Jesus issue. And the truths that we hold are not widely accepted. And when we share those truths as the word of God tells us to share those truths, it is not well received. We need the power of the Holy Spirit so that you and I can stand strong. And the only thing saving this world from the wrath of God right now are the believers who are here standing in the gap and representing Jesus well. We need all the time to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Peter and John, against opposition, stood full of the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit enables us to stand strong in the face of adversity. Fast forward a little bit, let's talk about the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul comes to know Jesus in Acts chapter 9. He's filled with the Holy Spirit in Ananias' house. Maybe you remember the story. He's on the road to Damascus. God speaks to him from heaven. Paul gets knocked off his high horse, literally, lands on the ground, and God says, "Why are you persecuting me?" Then Saul goes blind. You could read it from there. Acts chapter 9, Paul comes to Christ. Four chapters later, we're in Acts chapter 13, and Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, comes face to face with the works of the enemy. Acts chapter 13, verse 6. Let's read it. "Now that when they had gone through the island to Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus. He was with the proconsul, a Roman official, Sergius Paulus, an intelligent man. And this man called for Barnabas and Saul, Paul, and sought to hear the word of God, but Elymas the sorcerer," that's who this false prophet sorcerer Bar-Jesus was, "he withstood them, seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith." So let me just paint the picture for you. Paul and Barnabas are going through this area preaching the faith. This Roman official, a high-ranking man, hears word of it and he sends to them to say, "Hey, I want to hear what you're talking about." And this sorcerer guy tries to get in between Paul and Barnabas preaching the word to an unsaved man. Paul's response is in verse 9. "Then Saul, who is also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at this sorcerer," this Elymas, "and he said, 'O full of all deceit and all fraud, you son of a devil.'" That's what it says. "You enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease perverting the straight ways of the Lord? And now indeed the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you shall be blind, not seeing the sun for a time. And immediately a dark mist fell on him, and he went around seeking someone to lead him by the hand. Then the proconsul," the Roman official, "believed when he saw what had been done, and being astonished at the teaching of the Lord." So Paul, now listen, the message of this isn't when someone gets in the way of you witnessing, curse them with blindness. Although I could think of some areas where that'd be really handy. More than that, Paul did not back down when confronted with the work of the enemy. Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, stood in power. And because of his boldness and because of his willingness to face the enemy head on, this Roman official believes. This Roman official puts his faith in Jesus. We need the Holy Spirit for boldness, and we need the Holy Spirit to confront the sin in our lives and to confront the sin that we're faced with every single day. Now listen, Paul wasn't going around yelling at sinners and calling them out, right? It's Paul who wrote, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." That wasn't the case at all. But as Paul was preaching, when he was confronted with the enemy, when he was confronted with the work of the devil, with the sin that was around him, Paul did not hesitate to push through and to represent Jesus well. Paul confronted sin, and in the same way, the Holy Spirit helps us to confront the sin both in our own lives and the sin that is around us. We need to be filled continuously with the power of the Holy Spirit so that we can stand strong against an enemy who hates us. In Acts chapter 13, there's a little holy war going down here. We have Paul standing in the power of the Holy Spirit, and then we have this sorcerer, you know, representing the power of the enemy, and in the middle, there's a soul. There's a Roman official who needs to know the word, and you see the power of good versus the power of evil. We recognize first the power of evil has no chance, and then you see this man put his faith in Jesus. In the same way, believer, we're in a spiritual battle. We may not see it in the physical, but trust me, it's there in the spiritual. And what's hanging in the balance, souls that need to know him. And if we as believers allow the enemy to win, allow the enemy to silence us, allow the enemy to gain ground and refute our message, souls will be lost. But the church, standing on the rock, Jesus Christ, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, must go forward, and we overcome, and we preach the word, and the gates of hell will not be able to withstand the church. That's what Jesus told us. The gates of hell don't stand a chance. So we storm the gates, and we pull out sinners who would be lost without Jesus. This is exactly what Paul is doing as this spiritual battle takes place. Paul confronts the sin. He confronts the evil around him. And in the same way, we need to confront the sin in our lives, in our families, all around us. Paul was not passive about confronting the works of the devil. Too many believers today have grown passive. And you've allowed sin and the works of the enemy to mess up your life, to mess up your family, to mess up the world around you, because you didn't confront it, because you didn't address it. Sometimes we're guilty. We don't want to stand out. We don't want to make waves. We don't want to make a scene. We have all the excuses in the world, but ultimately we cower and we let sin have its way. And we fail to stand and represent Jesus. Paul was not going to have that. Paul was not looking for popularity. He wasn't looking to gain followers or likes. He was looking to represent Jesus well. And for him to do that, he needed to be filled continuously with the power of the Holy Spirit. You and I need to be filled continuously with the power of the Holy Spirit. One more story from the book of Acts. Let's back up to Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6 and chapter 7 shares with us the story of a very godly man named Stephen. It's a great name. Stephen in Acts chapter 6 and 7, we're told about him. He's going to become the first martyr of the church, the first one to give his life after Jesus died for us on the cross. But in Acts chapter 6, there's a problem in the early church. The problem has to do with some people feeling left out, which is always the case with people. So the disciples decide they don't want to be distracted from the preaching of the word and prayer. That was their job. So they appointed a handful of men to deal with this issue, to make sure that the widows were properly taken care of. And one of the heads of this group was a man named Stephen. In verse 5 of Acts chapter 6, they present the plan to deal with this issue, and the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and full of the Holy Spirit. And it says in verse 8, and Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. So as the apostles went out and preached the word, Stephen stayed close to home. And he took care of the needs that were in the immediate area. And as he did it, he went out preaching the word, full of the power of the Holy Spirit. Signs and wonders accompanied his preaching, and many lives were impacted. Good, 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 and good. However, just like with Peter and John and Paul later, there was opposition. There were those who did not want to hear the message of Jesus. There were those who did not like what Stephen was standing for. So he faced opposition from the crowd. And Stephen goes on, and basically the entirety of chapter 7, he does a history lesson with the Jews and talks about all the ways God delivered them, even though they were stubborn and rejected him. It was a very good sermon. But in essence, Stephen was preaching his funeral. At the conclusion of this sermon, they will grab Stephen, they will throw him in the middle, and they will stone him to death with rocks, and he will become the first martyr for the church. As Stephen is preaching, in verse 51, he wraps it up with this. You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in your heart and your ears. You always resist the Holy Spirit as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the Just One, of whom you now have become the betrayers and murderers. You who have received the law by the direction of angels, but did not keep it. Stephen goes out and he boldly preaches the word of God. And the people were enraged. The next verse tells us that they were cut to the heart and they were furious. It actually says they were gnashing their teeth at him. Absolutely furious that Stephen would call them out as the murderers of the Messiah, of the ones just like their forefathers who rejected everyone that God sent to them. At the conclusion of his preaching, Stephen is then executed. But the story didn't end there. There's one more verse, one more interesting verse, and we learn a little something about what happens when we stand for Jesus and we share our faith. Verse 58 and 59 says this. They cast him out of the city and they stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes, their coats, at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God, saying, Lord, receive my spirit. As they went to execute Stephen, there was a young man there. And as they took off their cloaks so they can really get a little pepper on those rocks, they laid them at the feet of a young man named Saul. Saul goes on to become Paul. We just talked about his story. What Stephen was doing as he preached the gospel to people who didn't want to hear it, we use this phrase sometimes. He was planting seeds. There was a young man there, young man who was raised in the Jewish tradition, a young man who later would at first go out and persecute these Christians. As he heard Stephen's message and saw the testimony of his life, a seed was planted in young Paul. And later, that seed would be watered, it would be nurtured, the Holy Spirit would continue to move on Paul until that day when God finally calls Paul to serve him. And Paul responds. But a seed was planted because despite terrible opposition, Stephen, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, did not back down for a second, and he shared the word boldly, even though it would cost him his life. And that seed becomes Paul. And Paul becomes the greatest missionary this world has ever known. And Paul writes a third of the Bible, a third of the New Testament. And Paul travels all over Asia, planting churches, raising disciples. And these 12 men and Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit, go out and they change not just the nation, they change the world. Because Stephen, filled with the Holy Spirit, obeyed. He shared. It all starts with planting a seed. And believer, that is all we're called to do. We are called to share Jesus, to share him boldly, to share him confidently, to share him with the power of the Holy Spirit, and we are planting seeds. We are casting out the seed. Jesus uses the parable of the sower to illustrate how we just need to go out and we need to tell people. We need to cast that seed. And some are going to receive it, great, and some aren't. But that's not our concern. Our job is to plant seeds. Believer, this is what we're called to do. And if we're going to do this effectively, like Peter and John, like Paul, like Stephen, we need to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. The purpose for this power was very clear. It was first power. The purpose of the filling of the Holy Spirit is power. Power to live and power to boldly be his witness. Being filled with the Holy Spirit helps us with both. To be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. I said earlier today, the world needs the church. It needs the followers of Jesus to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit because they need to hear it. They need to hear that good news from us. I'll ask the worship team to come and join us as we get ready to wrap up and spend a little time seeking God this morning. We're commanded to be filled with the Holy Spirit, whether it's the first time or whether it's again and again and again. We want to continue to be full. In 1 Samuel in the Old Testament, there's a reference to King Saul, who God chose to be the first king of Israel. And it tells us in 1 Samuel 16 that the Spirit of the Lord left Saul. It departed from him. We read about Samson in the book of Judges. And it tells us in the book of Samson, you know, Samson, the strongest guy, it tells us that the power of God left Samson and he didn't even know it. I think it's true today. Experience would tell us that there are believers who maybe even at one time were full of the power of the Holy Spirit, but they've run dry. Maybe they've just given out a lot and they've just grown tired and they need to be refilled. Maybe there's some like Samson who through rebellion, rejection of God, Holy Spirit left him altogether and he didn't even know it. We need to not just one time be filled, but we need to live filled. We need to be continually filled. Our families need us to be filled. This church needs to be filled. This community needs to see a church that is filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. And just because you were at one time filled with the Holy Spirit, it does not necessarily mean you are still filled with the Holy Spirit. Because we see in Scripture, it happened to them repeatedly. They stayed constantly full of the Holy Spirit. And that's the call for you and I. The church does not thrive in lukewarm complacency. Talked about being lukewarm Wednesday night at Bible study. That's not how the church thrives. The church thrives when the fire of the Holy Spirit is burning in the people. And when that fire is burning, the world knows about it. They hear about it. We share the word and we live boldly and we represent Jesus well. We're not just trying to get through. We're not just trying to survive. We're not all consumed with just ourselves. We're in the power of the Holy Spirit and we're sent, each and every one of us. And that's what we'll talk about next week. Sent to a world that desperately needs to hear the good news. And they might not like it. And they might not like you, but we stand for Jesus. We need to be filled with his power. I want this church to be a gas station for you. I want this to be a place where you can come in on a Sunday when after the last couple days of the week, you have just been poured out for Jesus. And you are running dry, and you come into this place where the Spirit of God can just fill you and refill you and fill you again so that we can once again go out and pour out into a world that desperately needs it. We were here a couple weeks ago. We were worshiping. It wasn't even an altar call. And as we were worshiping, we had a young lady filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit right over here. We've had people in our church who prayed at the altar to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and really they didn't feel like anything happened. And as they drove home later in their truck, they begin speaking in tongues, and the Holy Spirit touches them right there, right where they are. The Holy Spirit's not limited to church. He's not limited to an altar, but he is limited to you being open. You need to open your heart and say, Jesus, baptize me. Holy Spirit, fill me. Why? Because we want signs and wonders? No. Because we need the power of God to stand for him and represent him well. And this community, that's how they need us to be. Because there's people all around us this morning. They need Jesus. And Jesus has left you and I here to tell them. That's why we're here. We need in our lives every moment of every day to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, at your homes, with your family, with your children, to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, on your jobs, in your workplace, in those break room conversations, to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, in your neighborhood, in your community, in your schools. The world needs Jesus. That spiritual battle is happening, and we represent him. And we need to be filled. We need to be filled to overflowing. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? As we close this service today, I'm going to invite you to come. And if you're here and you just need to be filled with the power of God, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You need to be refilled with the Holy Spirit. You just need more of Jesus. Your tank has run dry. You've grown empty. You've grown weary. I want you to know today, we need this. We all need this every day. I'm not asking you if you need this. We all need this. To be constantly filled and refilled and overflowing with the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And in just a few moments when the team comes, I want to invite you to get out of your seat, to make your way down front here, to find a place and just begin to praise and worship God and ask the Holy Spirit to fill you up. Because in a few moments, church is over and we're right back out there in an unbelieving world, in a world full of sin and opposition and adversity. And we, the followers of Christ, need to be fully ready, fully prepared, and filled with the Holy Spirit. God, that's our prayer this morning, is that we, your church, would be a bright, on fire, shining light for you. And Lord, you gave us your Holy Spirit for this purpose. When you ascended into heaven, you said you would not leave us, alone. You would not leave us, but you would send the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth. And Lord, you have sent your Holy Spirit to us to give us everything that we need for life, for godliness. Holy Spirit, baptize. Holy Spirit, fill to overflowing. Lord, let this church be a refill station where we just soak you up so we can go into a world that desperately needs you, and that we can share the good news, that we could plant some seeds, Jesus, that you would be glorified. Father, fill your church to overflowing. We ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Stand together with me, and as the worship team is playing this final song, I just invite you to respond to God. Let's fill this altar. Let's spend a few moments today seeking the Lord. Let's be filled and refilled and overfilled. And then when we leave this place, let's be ready. Let's be ready to represent him well. Let's worship him, church.
There's nothing worth more. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. As I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, yeah. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence. There's nothing worth more. For there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Right here in your presence, Lord. Sing, I've tasted and seen. And seen of the sweetest of love, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, open our hearts to you right now. Everybody say, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory. We want to experience you right now, my God. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your presence. Fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what my heart longs for, to be overcome.
If you are thinking about getting out of your seat, but you haven't yet, I invite you, don't let anything hold you back. There's plenty of room up here. Get out of your seat.
Freedom reigns. Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace, they are falling on every face. There is freedom.
See where the Spirit of the Lord is.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So lift your eyes to heaven. There is freedom. Lift your eyes to heaven. There is freedom.
His presence is right here in this room. You feel it? It's so powerful. Sing it out with me.
Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom if you're tired and thirsty. So if you're tired and thirsty, come right now, because there is freedom. Oh, if you're tired, and if you're tired and thirsty, yeah, there is freedom. You've got to give your all to Jesus. For there is freedom. You've got to give your all to Jesus. There is freedom. Jesus reigns.
Soak it in, piano, just keep playing. Still early, we got time. Jesus is here, he's moving, he's filling people.
It's falling on your face. We have his freedom. We have your freedom. The Spirit of the Lord is. Encounter your presence. There's nothing like your presence. There is freedom. Thank you. great, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. Great is our God. Sing how great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Sing, you're the name above all names.
You are the name above all names.
He's worthy of our praise.
Worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God. You're the name above. You are the name above all names. For you are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God. You're the name above all names. You are the name above all names. You are worthy of all praise.
My heart will sing.
And my heart will sing how great is our God.
Sing it out, the name above all names.
How great is our God. One more time. And all will see. And all will see how great. How great is our God.
Praise you, King. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're still baptizing and filling to overflowing. And Lord, we pray for your church, for this church, for these people. God, for this worship team, for myself, for our staff. Lord, that you would fill us again and again and again, overflowing with the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, that when we leave this place, it's not just what happens here, but God, as we leave this place, that we would walk in the fullness of your power. Lord, make us bright lights. Lord, help us to speak your word with confidence. Lord, help us to just confront the enemy at every turn and to preach your freedom and your healing and your saving power. Lord, to plant seeds everywhere we go. Holy Spirit, empower us. Fill us, Lord. Fill your church. Lord, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for your presence so powerful in this place. Thank you, Lord God.
Church, as we rejoice, I just want to close with that opening song that we sang earlier. You could stay right here, but I just feel like we gotta end in absolute victory. So if you're with me, won't you just hang around for a few more minutes? Let's go. We're going to do this thing. You got to put your hands together. Do you see what I see? Do you see what I see? Come on. And I see lightning, I hear thunder. Something stirring 6 feet under. Again, I believe there's about to be another resurrection. Yeah. I see signs and I see wonder. I see birds of living color. Dead things, come on. The dead things coming back to life again. I believe there's about to be another resurrection.
fully know your